I think I'm going to start, or is there some discussion going on in the audience? Okay, I'm going to talk about long-term maintenance, and by long-term I mean systems that need to be supported for more than 10 years. Short survey, please raise your hands. Who of you have developed embedded Linux systems? Stupid question here, about 90%, I think. Which of these systems are in the field? Even more, I think. You don't know. How old are these systems? 5 years? Still someone? Okay. 20%? 10 years? 1, 2 people? Impressive. Which of these systems use components like the kernel, the glibc, which are still maintained today? Oh, one. Good. Have you had a security vulnerability in the main time, like in the 10 years? How long did it take to fix you these problems?
When we had it. I mean, we were able to make an update whenever we want, but it was on aircraft, so it depends on when the aircraft is available.
Okay, so the system was on the aircraft and there, it's not connected to the internet, and so it should be no problem.
It should be a manual update, so you have to be grounded. So it was more likely a month at least.
Okay, it took you a month, not bad.
Before producing the patch, before being able to apply.
Okay, so you needed one month to fix. To develop a patch and update it. Impressive, that's good. Maybe we can get into a discussion how you solve the problem later. The time frame it should take should of course be very, very small between you noticed and you can actually get out a fix into the system, into the field, because systems can be remotely exploited, automated, and you don't want to go there. Some context about this conversation, about this talk. It's focused on small teams. We at Pangotronics work with like 10 or less people for the kernel and for the platform team. And our customers we have, they usually have teams of less than 10 people which are working with us on the platform. And these customers, they don't use off-the-shelf PC hardware, usually embedded systems, ARM processors is widely spread, and so they cannot use mainline server distributions, desktop distributions, because there you would have to maintain the changes you made against Debian or Red Hat, and then there is the update problematic. This is not suitable. So they have custom hardware with custom modifications in the software down low, and this is what we focus on. And these customers, they support these systems for 10 or 15 years, but they don't build a system and select like 15 years and do nothing in between. They roll out a product, a new product, every 2 or even each year. And then there are a lot of different products in the field. All of them have to be maintained and updated. And then supported for more than 10 years. And these are the lessons learned at Pangotronics. We work in the embedded industry and create board support package for customers in Germany or and help them to focus on this. And we have done a lot of really mainline focused projects like get out your patches as soon as possible, keep the difference between what's on the system and what's in the mainline kernel relatively low. Zero patches would be optimal. So this is what a traditional, I would say, embedded system lifecycle looks like. You start, you choose some versions of your kernel, your glibc, your security libraries, and so on. You took those, get a build system like Yocto, like we heard before, put in the kernel, the bootloader, the user space, then add your customization layers, then the layer for your application, build that, test that, write some documentation maybe, roll it out, then it's start of production and at least the customer hopes traditionally that there will be no changes needed to the platform. So then there comes the maintenance phase of 10 or 15 years. In the meantime, the customers have noticed that they need to provide updates for their own applications because they want to add new features, because not everything was ready from the beginning, or there were some changes in the regulatory domain they had to apply. They have, hopefully, a process for rolling out those updates for their own stuff, but they hope at least there will be no changes needed for the platform. But this is not the case. If you look at these charts, they are from the CVE database, so the common vulnerabilities are listed here. I won't go into detail, these are quite a lot. These are the major components that are used in, I think, most of the embedded systems, the kernel, the glibc, and the OpenSSL library. Not all of them are remote code execution, which of course is total disaster critical. Most of them, I think, are denial of service attacks. You might think, I don't care. But if you have an embedded system that does some critical task, and if you can remotely crash your kernel or remotely crash your glibc, your OpenSSL, and your embedded system fails to provide that critical task, then this denial of service CVE somehow turns into a critical CVE for you. So you have to take care about those too. There are about, in total, 100 CVEs per, in some of these components per year, per system. So it's quite a lot. And not these unintentional problems that we find in the kernel or the other components. There is this infamous backdoor in the Allwinner vendor kernel. So vendors, they sometimes or mostly don't care about security. They don't care about maintainability. And sometimes they even build backdoors into their own vendor kernels. This vendor kernel from Allwinner that was uploaded to GitHub. And in the default configuration, if you just take the code from GitHub, there is this proc file. So you just print their root my device, and whoops, the process who who has just done this now gains root access on the system. And this was in the default configuration in the vendor-provided kernel by Allwinner, and it was active, and it was used on products out there in the field, and it was open like a barn door, or I don't know how you say that in English. So don't trust your vendor kernel. It all happens because the vendors think, I don't care about the review process on the Linux mailing list, I just dump my stuff out there. The hardware vendors don't care about maintainability, and they don't care about the quality that comes into the kernel or in the other components if you upstream your stuff. A backdoor like this would never have been accepted into the Linux kernel, and this is probably the reason why we just heard the talk before. Why the kernel support for the new SOC is done by professionals and included into mainline and not rotting in the vendor kernel. So another problem is what we have seen in the field, that companies are using pre-built binary distributions like Debian or Red Hat that are mainly targeted for servers or desktop PCs for their board support. But there is no real workflow if you have differences between your product and the pre-built binary stuff what's distributed by Debian. So every company that uses a pre-built distribution on their embedded system, they have to invent and maintain an infrastructure to keep that changes what you have and what's in the distribution. And another problem comes when you have to update from the old Debian release to the next one, or same applies to Red Hat. And the problem is embedded companies tend to, or embedded developers tend to use a long-term marked kernel. Long-term sounds good, but when they have no update concept, they pick a random long-term kernel, work on this at their patches, but when they have no update concept, they have this old kernel, but they fear to update it because they have no concept, no established workflow. This is also not good. So you end up with an old kernel because it's long-term, and you don't update to the newest of these long-term releases because you're afraid. So it's the worst of both worlds. Yeah, this leads to a next problem. Not only the kernel, but the other components. If you have no proven and trained process how to do the updates, you avoid them because you fear. If you have no test suite, no automation, then you avoid the costs and all the time it takes to do an update, and it might crash my system or whatever. We've seen all this. And sometimes the vendors get feedback by reading about their device in the news, on the Heise news ticker or something else. But this is usually not good news, and then it's already too late because, yeah, your reputation is really down for years. So we see continuous maintenance is very important. All of those 100 CVEs per year per system, there are usually one or two for each system that are really, really important for your system. Not all of the 100, because maybe you don't have the configuration active, maybe you don't use the network protocol that's affected by the CVE, maybe you have a different use case and can rule them out, but there will be ones that will affect your system. So continuous maintenance is important. Another problem is when you want to reach a 10 to 15 year lifespan of your system, the upstream projects, like the kernel, the glibc, OpenSSL, they have maintenance releases, but they usually have a lower lifespan on those, like 2 to 5 years, but not 10. This is why you have to update regularly, but more on this later. Server distributions, binary ones, they don't really fit into the embedded world because they are focused that an admin can log in, do the update manually, or if you have a bigger deployment, you use something like Puppet. but we simply don't have the resources on embedded systems for monsters like Puppet to run on it. It needs Ruby and online. You need to access the system, so it's not suited. Service distries rely that you, if something breaks, you can log in, or when you're in a cloud environment, you just deploy the system from scratch, and this is not possible in the embedded world. The system needs to run several years without interaction, so we have a different focus in the embedded world than the server distros. Some people suggest backporting. Backporting, what is this? You start with a version of a kernel or your component, and you backport the patches which are necessary. You look at the upstream, you look at the maintenance releases, what happens there, maybe you even look at the new releases, what happens there. There are new features added to the kernel, and there are security fixes. Then you can start backport some security fixes. It works in the beginning, but over the time, the kernel grows and grows, and you have more and more local modifications, and it's more difficult to test. You have a low test coverage. No one is using the kernel you have picked together. So the technical term for this is a Frankenkernel, when there are so many backports of so many subsystems that you don't know what you actually have. When you find a bug there, you are on your own. No one in the community can help you. And you are effectively losing what makes the Linux community or the open source community, that several people or many people have the same software. So you have a big test coverage, you lose this. And further, after years and years of doing backports, maybe even the maintenance window of that upstream version you picked closes, then you have to really focus on every commit, or pick a different maintenance version upstream and look there, and it's really doesn't scale. And the problem is, if you have more than one of these 10-year going projects, you have to do this for every project, so it doesn't scale because you have so many diverge versions. The problem is, we have to do this for a lifetime of 10, 15 years. Backporting is unsustainable on these time scales. So what do we want? Let's take a step back. We have the problem, we want a really short time between the moment we notice that there is an incident and the moment we can roll out our fix. Because it's getting worse and worse. Automated exploitation, or the time it takes for hackers to do automated exploitation, is getting shorter and shorter and shorter. Remember, when was it, last year? We had this army of Linux-based surveillance cameras. They all have been automatically hacked because their systems were so old. They turned into bots that hack other systems which have the same problem. And there was a bot army of millions of devices that target core infrastructure of the internet and did denial of service attacks there. And when we do updates, we want to have low risk of side effects. When you update your kernel, when you update your glibc, you want to ensure that nothing breaks. Nothing breaks the application. Nothing is more shameful when you tell your customer, oh, you have to update, because there is a security vulnerability, and this breaks the system. That's not good. So we want to have a low risk of side effects and so on. And for small teams like us and our customers, you really want to predict the costs, and the cost should be low over the maintenance period. You want to predict how much work is needed for this process. And last but not least, this should be scalable for many product for many products, because when a company has products with a lifespan of 10 years and brings a new product every 2 years, you have after 10 years you have 5 products and 5 different versions you have to look at, and it's not scalable. So it should scale to multiple products. And of course, what do we want? New features for free. Because if you update to a new kernel, the upstream is not lazy. They fix security bugs and vulnerabilities, and they add new features. And if you update to a newer kernel version or glibc version or whatever component, you get new features for free and can roll out them to your customers, and your customers are happier than ever. So what are the ingredients for a sustainable process like this? We suggest that you always use the latest still maintained upstream, because pick an upstream version that is supported for at least 4 years, so that in the future you see you have no immediate reason to do an update. Then what's also good is that you minimize your attack surface. The kernel has many, many configuration options. Switch them all off that are not needed in your kernel. Disable the network protocols that are not needed, because if they are not active, a security vulnerability won't affect you there. And newer kernels get ever more hardening features, as well as the toolchain, your compiler, and your glibc. Enable these features, use them, because they can sometimes mitigate or lower the effects of the CVEs found in your system. What's also important is that you have a well-known process for building all your components. We've already seen a talk, or heard a talk about Open Embedded. This is a possibility to build your stuff, which is well suited. There are other competitors on the market. Just choose one. You want to automate testing and rolling out releases. You want to automate deploying updates. Have I said automate everything already? If not, do it. Just automate it. Make use of automation, because when you do things by hand, they will break eventually, because you miss something. When we have a look at the system, every release you do, every release number you give to your systems should really define your system down to the latest byte, down to the last byte, or even bit. Because if you don't know what's in the field, you cannot fix it. We want to aim for, or our goal is bit by bit reproducibility of builds. It's not always possible, but at least it's a goal we want to aim for. And make sure you can upgrade, really, the components you have in the field. Not only the user space or your application or the kernel, also think about the bootloader. For example, if you have a secure boot installation, where the whole boot process from the ROM over the bootloader, the kernel, and the user space is checked, and you have security anchors everywhere. If one component in this chain is broken, your whole system doesn't work anymore, at least security-wise. And so you have to have the possibility to update everything, all your components in the field. This is a major ingredient for a sustainable process. So what we propose is a development workflow that looks like this. Submit your changes to your upstream Other people have said it, I said it before, bring your stuff into the kernel or have other companies to do that. Reduce the difference of your code base, of your patches against the upstream. This really reduces the maintenance effort. There are people out there that look at this and see problems that you don't even think of. They're really good and make use of the community. And automate everything. Building, testing, start with this automation early. Use it during development. Tell your customer how to use it. Or eat your own dog food. Have executable documentation like open embedded. Use build systems. Focus on reproducibility. Avoid mistakes. Build a process to build, roll out, test, deploy, release. There are systems like Jenkins for this or others. This is really getting easier and easier every year. Then stabilize. So the last point is about when you start developing, don't pick a stable kernel and start developing, because when you are through with the whole development cycle, you have suddenly an outdated version in use, because development usually takes 1 or 2 years. Just use the latest Git from kernel.org, develop your stuff on there, apply your patches, create them, mainline them, and when you start testing for release, then you should freeze your kernel, not earlier. Otherwise, you have just rolled out your product, and then you see, oh my God, it's already 2 years old kernel, and I have to do an update cycle just right after the release. This is just lost time. So the workflow we suggest: every year, pick the components of your system which are at least supported for the year to come, or even better, the newest version that's out there. In this year, there should be no unsupported version of a component in your system, because if a security incident happened, you want to be on a version that's supported by upstream, that you can import the fix, run your automated test suite that you have developed before, and roll out everything. Every year, when you start this workflow, you can have a look at your patches. How many are left? How many are still in my repo? The kernel has evolved, the kernel subsystems have evolved. Maybe they have a solution for your problem that you have formerly maintained in-house. Maybe maintainers have more insight, maybe they understand now your problem. Try to get out the patches. The next time you do this update cycle, you will be happy that you have less patches to drag behind you and update. And of course, we have developed the automated test suite and automated deploy suite before, during development. Now it's time to give it a kick and see, let it run overnight to see if there are some problems. If you have found new regressions, fix them, add them to your test suite, and just do the cycle that your system works again. Have a look at the security advisories, and if you see that you are not affected by any problems in the meantime, you can just use this updated system, put it on your shelf, and pick it out if a security vulnerability hits you. Then you are prepared, because you're on the latest version, you can import the fixes and roll it out. If you want to give your customers some newer versions, of course you can roll it out if you have done your update workflow like this. And for a more periodic maintenance every month, we suggest that you maintain or monitor the upstream releases more closely, maybe once a month or once a week, depends on the size of your project. Get involved with the community. The CVE database is out there. You can subscribe to mailing lists. You get informed as soon as there is a security vulnerability. You can update every month to the latest maintenance release. The changes are usually quite small, so the risk that something breaks is even less. Read the security announcements, evaluate, run your test suite. If nothing is in the security announcement, everything is good. If something should happen, just apply the fix from upstream. Because you are on the maintained version, you can do it. You have previously tested your system. The delta is quite small. Set up your test suite again. Let it run. Use your automated build, test, deploy, and release process, and bring your fix into the field. Yeah, there are some tools that you can use. Some of these are used by us and our customers. For automation of processes, building, testing, and so on, we use Jenkins, and Jenkins with version 2 has been added pipeline support. It's really nice for system integration. For test automation, we use Lava. It's by the Linaro people, where you can actually plug in your board into a web-controllable server, and the server uses the output from Jenkins, pushes it to your board, and runs the test you have on the image, and gives you feedback. You can also participate in a kernel CI, where you voluntarily give access to a board. The kernel CI builds the latest, greatest kernel, pushes it to your system, and tests if your system still works with the latest kernel, and you get feedback. Even before the code hits mainline, they use different kernels like Linux Next and different subsystem kernels. Use a redundant bootloader, or a bootloader that can boot redundantly, because even if you test your updates, something might fail, and you don't want to brick your system in the field. There are bootloaders that can roll back to the latest version that you have deployed. For example, Barebox supports it out of the box via BootChooser. You can customize it. Sorry?
I'm just reading the claim on this menu.
Yeah. Use Barebox. BootChooser is a customizable framework where you can describe how your redundant boot scenario looks like. U-Boot and this other bootloader for x86 systems, you can do the same with customizable scripts or with custom scripts. With UEFI, that's available on x86 and ARM64 server hardware, you can do something similar with variables. This is quite nice, redundant boot. You can, for example, if booting of the new system fails, just switch to the old system. Or if everything fails, boot into some rescue system where you tell the customer, oh, please call the support. And there are different systems out there to install or the updates. And just pick one. There are several. And depending on the size of your installation in the field, there are rollout schedulers. For really big installations, you can do something like Google does. first roll out your update to 10 devices, see for some days if they work, and then gradually increase the number of devices you update, and then update the whole bunch. Maybe you can just use a static web server where the devices check. Depends on your scenario. Okay. The conclusion of all this. Many approaches have failed. The so-called security by ignorance doesn't work. You can ignore the problem, but the hackers or the automated tools, they won't. Your system will be owned, and your reputation will go downstairs. Maybe you can do ad hoc fixes for some outdated version out there in the field. This will probably work once or twice, but after the third update, you don't know what's really on the system when you have no process for this, no proper versions, just ad hoc fixes. It doesn't scale, and it's not reliable. And we've seen server distributions, they don't work for the embedded use case yet, or not, because they have a different focus. You need bigger tool stacks like Puppet or something. So it is possible if you do it right. Upstream your changes, bring down the number of patches you have, bring down the number of changes. Just use a recent version of everything, your build system, the kernel, the bootloader, your glibc. Of course, you change a lot in your system, but if you have automated everything properly, an automated test suite, an automated build system, automated deployment, this process is not that complicated and not that time intensive. So create a sustainable workflow, and your system should be up to date for a long time to come. So there's no more excuses for badly maintained embedded products. I hope I've inspired some of you not to let your systems rot away. Please do your updates. Thank you. The mic.
About backporting, I would just mitigate it, because sometimes this is a sole option. Maybe sometimes in between two releases. We had a case where we were requiring some patches on the kernel, but the stable one was refusing the patches because of the rules of the kernel itself. And so we knew that we have to maintain this backporting on Assumit, but doing it properly, just by maintaining all the commit hashes, tracing them, and applying them properly, just to know that this is the regular kernel, and we are taking these patches from this branch because we have no other option right now, because the kernel stable we choose doesn't accept these patches right now because of the policy. So sometimes it could be a transition between two versions when you can't apply, when you need some features, but you cannot apply it directly on upstream project.
Yeah, if you are in the lucky position that your patches you pick are already in some upstream branches or even in mainline.
It was.
It was, then you are really lucky, because in the next cycle you update to a newer kernel, these patches automatically go away. So this, how is it called, technical debt is not that bad, because you know the patches are going away, or they are already away, but not in your system.
That's why I wanted to mitigate. Sometimes you can accept it, because you know the price of it, and you can save your life temporarily while waiting the next version.
Yes.
And so that can make a transition and solve it. And if you do it properly, you don't lose all the benefits of the traceability, of the reproducibility, of this stuff.
Yes, because everything was already or is mainline, or is mainline shortly, then you are on a good way with your patches, because they are not your patches, because they are from upstream somewhere. So it's acceptable.
Yep.
From my point of view.
For ours too.
Actually, I just want to go over through something that, like, we did an experiment at Red Hat when I was working for Red Hat for the real-time division. We had a little more freedom than Red Hat Enterprise Linux. We said, you know, let's try to stay as close to the mainline as possible. And a lot of people were like saying, well, is it going to be stable, or is it going to be crashing? We actually, just to let people know, it was actually quite stable. We really didn't have much issue with staying close to mainline. And that worked, we kept going. In fact, actually, we found out we had some customers that decided to buy the real-time project just because they wanted to be closer to mainline.
Uh-huh.
Well, they found out that when they ran 1,000 threads and we serialized the read-write semaphore, which is the memory management semaphore, it killed their, the system didn't perform at all. But we found out that's how we found out that why they bought the real-time kernel, because I'm like, they didn't need the real-time. But yes, it works. Unfortunately, Red Hat has a guarantee of kernel ABI, which is going to keep it stable. So if you anyone else that's developing is a little worried about staying, you know, keep going, we didn't find that keeping it close to mainline, we weren't at mainline, we're, you know, staying with stables going up, bouncing each time,
yeah,
is not really as much of an issue with security and bugs as you may think it is, would be, with all the development going on. I just want to reiterate that.
Thank you.
Could you go back just to maybe one or two slides back? Yeah, that one. Do you have some more insights about the, which one is it? Yeah, the fourth line, the update, installer, and recovery sections, like,
yeah.
Which ones do you use? Which ones work better than the others?
This is not my specialty, but you use Rauk because we have invented it. yeah, it was really funny last ELCE in, what was it, Berlin? Suddenly everyone was having some installer recovery auto-update thingy out there. Everyone said nothing was out there before we started, and I think all are telling the truth. They have different aspects on what they focus. We use Rauk, it's fully cryptographically secured possibility to update the kernel, the bootloader, the system. Basically have two partitions and flash one or write one while the other one is running, and with support from the bootloader switch atomically into the other system. I don't know much details about the other two.
Okay, thank you.
You said the server distributions were not suitable for embedded device because you couldn't run something like Puppet or, I don't know, other ones.
Yep.
So to you, if you can run Ansible or something and you can have it to maintain your server distributions on your embedded product, then it's okay?
Depends. If you have access to, or if your customer gives you access to their boards, or our customer sells their boards to their customers, and then we or our customers has to access with Ansible the system of the third customers, it's a bit more problematic. Maybe you can do it. Probably depends on your use case.
Your talk focused a lot on kernel and the libc and the basic low-level components.
The platform.
Pardon?
The platform, as
yes.
We call it.
My experience is when we have problems of obsolescence, it's mainly about all the other components, the libraries that are used by the user, the main applications, which are not updated or abandoned or stuff like that, and which means that when we follow upstream, we have to backport stuff which has not been compiled on modern Linux systems sometime for years. Any advice on that aspect?
So you are the libraries you're using, they have not released for years?
They're not maintained.
They're not maintained.
It's something when you go for a long time that ends up happening quite a lot.
Yes,
but the problem is where you can, it depends on the, the workforce you have on the project, and mainly the workforce your customer has on the project, because usually, I don't know how you work, but our customers tend to try to maintain stuff themselves, which is a problem by itself, but that's what's happened. And they have usually one guy, and he's not always the best guy at Linux possible, and he has to follow CVEs, and he has to follow kernels, and he has to learn Yocto, and it's a lot of stuff. So maintaining a dozen applications that start not compiling anymore because libc has changed, because there's a new kernel features that you need to enable on the command line to reactivate a security feature that has been disabled because it was dangerous, that sort of stuff, it's hard.
Yeah, this is, abundant user space libraries is really a problem. I acknowledge that. Depends on your team size. It's probably best to hook up to some distribution. They usually maintain patches, Debian, Red Hat. Maybe you can, if you have your own patches, get them upstream at your distribution you're using on your development PC.
Well, having a distribution that has a good patch handling, I'd say, mechanism, like Yocto, where you can keep your patch in your layer's health.
You don't want to keep the patch in your layer.
Pardon?
You don't want to keep the patch in your layer, you want to keep it...
Well, if upstream basically doesn't exist anymore, not only do you want to keep your patch, you also want to keep the downloaded sources, because they might disappear.
You have to back up all your sources anyway.
Yeah.
But if you're using Yocto, maybe Yocto can... You can apply or get upstream your patches to Yocto.
To some extent.
Yeah.
Not when it's when the software is not in Yocto anymore because it has been abandoned upstream. It happens.
Yeah, or bring it upstream into your Debian or Red Hat, the patch.
Yeah.
And use this as an upstream. In the back, can you... You already said something. Can you throw it in the back? And then you are... Thank you.
Merci. Thank you. You said that new features come for free, but in fact, it's not completely free because the software has an impact on size, kernel size, binary size. So is there a risk that after 10 years, I cannot run the latest kernel and application on the old on the old hardware?
You do not update after 10 years. You, in what we propose, update every year or even after your kernel, and then you run your test suite, and then you probably or hopefully not only have does my application run tests, but also some performance tests, and you see regressions in performance, and then you can go to upstream and say, the semaphore has killed my, what was it? The conversion of the semaphore has killed my threads or whatever, and upstream will fix the problems, hopefully. But kernels will or tend to increase in size, but there are projects like the, what's it called, small kernel patches.
What if upstream doesn't care because you're the only one affected by the problem?
Give your upstream a kick in the butt. If it's a problem, they should be improve your social skills and convince them. There was a question here.
One was just another item to put on your good advice list. One is don't postpone the scrubbing process to update something. Updating from version 1 to version 1.1 is not scary. Updating to 1 to 1.10 is much more because the change log is so big. So if you are just waiting too long, for example, for the kernel, I did it very often. Jumping from 30 to 35 is okay. From 30 to 50, it's just amazing. And if it breaks, then you are starting a very long process to find where it breaks and all this stuff. So if you are just changing very often, it's very easy to find what breaks something on faster your integration process. And the other item, because we are targeting a very, very long updating process, we are supposed to maintain 20 years our system. And our statement was, don't trust anyone to do this stuff for yourself in 10 years. So for example, your build system, you have to have your build systems. You should be able to compile everything by yourself.
Yes.
Because in 10 years, you don't know what would be the project.
Maybe
could be any distro, could be any project, you don't know what will be their status, their status in that time. So you have to do it by yourself, and you cannot trust anyone.
Yeah, I suggest build everything by your own, but don't fork from your project you are using. Don't fork from Yocto or whatever. Just
no, we just rebuild, for example, Debian locally with the same packages, with the same source, with the same process, but just to be sure that being in a position to do it later on.
Yeah, and do everything you need to do in a security incident. Like in this development phase of the project, create all your automation stuff you need to do to create everything from scratch and from source.
Yeah.
Olivia, the GStreamer guy, where is he? Is he hiding somewhere? There he is. He said something that, in his talk that kind of disturbed me a little bit, that actually is applicable here, about how users, and it will help you, user space tends to be more free with like changing of ABIs and APIs. I find that a big issue with user space, libraries and such like that. If we were more like the kernel with, was like, don't break user, like, kernel's very strict, do not break user space. People are shocked at that. I have a Fedora kernel 13, Fedora Core 13 that I'm running the latest kernel that's just released on. I do my testing on Fedora FC 13. And people say, that still boots that kernel? I'm like, yes, because we don't break user space. We go that long. And there's a lot of libraries out there that seem to break it every 6 months. If you have something depending on you, you should try to be a little more considerate of APIs. And that way, people over there, like yourself, would be able to, you know, keep maintaining stuff. And if something's like, okay, glibc changes, and now I have all these other things that have to be updated because of this, but there's three packages no longer maintained, now I'm the maintainer of them, or maybe 10 packages or 20 packages, I think we should consider a little bit more, for security and safety reasons, be a little bit more thought about keeping it more of a stable ABI, APIs.
And using proper versioning, like semantic versioning.
Well, not even just that. I mean,
it's part of this.
I mean, try to make it look a little bit longer further and don't get so, hey, we'll fix it next release.
Say, in user space, you can parallel install libraries. That's the big difference with the kernel. This is why it's not so bad. If our API sucks, maybe the code is okay. Maybe we just like, oh, this new feature, we can't enable it. You need the new API for that. Like, this is what we did with GStreamer.
That addition is fine, but don't change existing.
No, changing is bad, but then just make a new so name, right? It's a new library. It just happens to be called something v2, v3, v25. Which is, well, what kernel people do, right? They have system call 2, system call 3, system call 4. Yeah.
And this is what I meant with semantic versioning. Then you have a new library and by these three numbers. I don't really remember how to change them, but if you do it right, it simply works that you can install them in parallel and you are the dynamic loader just picks the newest one that's compatible with your application and it should work. Questions left? Who wants a board or Mike?
Yeah.
Questions? There will be probably. There is probably a fantastic website.
In a few days.
Okay, then, thank you.